Okay, now we're going to have a look at Don't Ban the Exam from the Insight Practice Exam 2012. In this one, actually, the cover page is the EAL cover page, but the piece I'm going to go through now is mainstream, but anyone is welcome to use this material. It's all good practice. If we have a look at the headline here, Don't Ban the Exam, we've got an instance of assonance. Assonance. Now, assonance is different from alliteration. Alliteration specifically means that the first letter, the consonants, are repeated in the words. So if you've got a series of words and they all start with an E, for instance, a vowel sound, that's assonance, not alliteration. In the middle of the words here, we've got an exam, like that. So it's repeating a vowel sound, so it's assonance, but it has the same kind of effect as alliteration, which is it's creating emphasis. So this phrase becomes more memorable, sticks in our mind, stands out, don't ban the exam. Now, the author opens with a very short statement here, exams. Okay, so that gives real pause for thought for the readers so they can start to think in their minds about what exams mean for them. And no doubt they'll probably have some sort of uncomfortable feelings, which is great because then the writer will go on to empathize with those feelings by saying that as a student herself, she used to be afraid of exams. So that pause gives the readers time to think of those feelings, which the writer then identifies with, and this creates a close association between the writer and the reader, a sense of empathy that she really understands what they are going through. And due to that closeness, and that feeling of understanding, the readers will be more likely to accept her point of view as she knows where they're coming from. But then, of course, she asserts her authority with a teacher of over 30 years' experience, and she mentions this right at the end of the piece as well. So, by mentioning that she's a teacher with so much experience, that gives her credibility, and so the readers would sort of respect her position and therefore be more likely to respect her point of view. Here is a bit of an implied attack. Only an uneducated person would argue that exams are outdated. So the readers wouldn't want to be considered to be uneducated. So therefore, they would want to be on her side, considering that exams are not outdated, in order to avoid the wrath of that attack. Down we here we have in a fair way, and this notion of fairness is repeated throughout the piece. We can see over here in the caption of the image, it also mentions fairness. Now, notice in the image, all the tables look fairly much identical and they're all lined up in rows, giving this sense of uniformity. So that replicates the idea that she talks about later in the piece, with the idea that exams are fair because all the students have the same opportunities to succeed. They're judged evenly and fairly. Now, there's a contrast here between radio talkback shows, research, and Dr. J. Smith of Medville University. By putting these next to each other, by juxtaposing them, one can easily see that talkback shows would have less credibility than research and a doctor or a professor. So, therefore, that manages to undermine the opposition towards exams, the radio talkback shows, because, in contrast to more credible forms of research, where they're not as sort of, as believable, as trustworthy. Notice that she uses inverted commas around real world and cramming. Now, sometimes inverted commas means that the author is trying to say that this is not a view that they necessarily support. So this might be implying that the author feels that there's not a whole lot of difference between the real world and the school world. So to sort of undermine that notion that there is a difference there. And also, she obviously doesn't support this notion of cramming, and she goes into that later. So by separating what she feels is her views and views that she doesn't really support by using inverted commas, we can start to understand her stance more clearly. So during the piece, she does use sort of small questions like why, or later on, she has another little one which is this fair? And so that is a chance during the piece as she's explaining and explaining and explaining to get the readers to have a little bit of a pause, a little bit of a think, and then she can move forward to sort of answer their questions and provide them the answers that they're searching for. She does mention a couple of times here and later on, as we all know. So this is a generalization, and it's also inclusive, and it puts all the readers in the same group. So they realize that they're meant to have this shared knowledge. So if they don't, they'll feel rather left out and maybe just take the knowledge on as their own in order to avoid that experience of being the outlier. Now, when we go down here, she has sort of a hypothetical situation of being a doctor in the emergency section of a hospital, and the thing, "hang on while I check my medical textbook to see what's wrong with you," sounds a little bit ridiculous. Therefore, we are more likely to see that proposal of exams aren't real world as being ridiculous as well, seeing that we would experience the same sort of pressure in an exam room as we would in a real life work situation. Now, down here, she lists all the benefits of a thesis. So by listing, we can see that her examination of the opposition's point of view is very comprehensive. So we can't accuse her of being biased without having done her research, and again, she gains credibility. Now, she uses the word skeptical here, and skeptical is probably a word that I'd use to describe her tone overall, because she's very skeptical about this idea of alternatives to exams. And by using an emotive word like that, the reader is encouraged to sort of empathize with that skepticism as well. A question like, "what is to stop some teachers and schools from giving high marks to students they like," is meant to capitalize on that sense of skepticism. So we can start to feel a bit cynical about how the thesis, the marking of the thesis, could be abused, creating a sense of doubt and therefore positioning the reader to object to this idea of having a thesis. We have down here an appeal to social justice, with this gap between students who are rich and those who are poor. So that's an appeal to social justice or fairness or equality. So generally, in sort of an egalitarian society that we live in, we don't want there to be a big difference between the rich and the poor. So anything that is likely to increase that gap is something that we would be positioned to oppose in order to keep fairness in society. Down here, there's an anecdote, a personal anecdote of her sister, showing how stressed out her sister was writing up her honours thesis. So an anecdote obviously brings that down to the personal level, shows that she's not generalising, that real people are suffering because they're doing theses. So that will help to make her point very clear that a thesis is not a great alternative. Notice the way that she ends in an exclamation mark. So that makes her point of view very assertive. Okay, exams have their place and should not be abandoned. So with that, it's just forcing that point through, making it really clear. There's sort of a sense of assertiveness that we're inclined to share. She's not subtle or unconvinced by this idea. She feels really, really strongly about that. And that can be persuasive when writers are very confident, excited, or enthusiastic about their point of view. So particularly with this piece, do notice that repetition. Things like, "as we all know," things like, "a teacher for over 30 years," the fact that those techniques are repeated many times would make it, I guess, seem to the assessor that it would be a bit strange if you didn't pick up on them. So they're what we would call the writer's signature techniques, the ones that she's really trying to capitalize on.